I want to wish everybody a happy new year who was traveling last week. This is your first Sunday. And of course, again, just welcoming those who are joining us online. You know, I've got a question for you, and I want you to think about this just for a moment. I think it's going to be a no-brainer, but we always hear about, boy, at the end of my life, I want to hear Jesus say, well done, good and faithful servant, right? But what about hearing Jesus say that at the end of 2023? You know, why do we think we have to wait until we're in heaven after our life's all over to hear that? Why can't we hear that at the end of this year? And I've said this before, if this is your best year spiritually, it's going to be your best year ever. And so that's what this is all about. I heard the cheer go up for 21 days of prayer and fasting. I think people don't understand it, probably think we're crazy. But I really am excited because I know God's moving on our behalf already and encouraging us towards these things. So this message today, I think it's going to be really helpful for you. But before we even get into that, Jonathan mentioned on Wednesday nights we're going to be here from 7 to 8 o'clock. We always have prayer requests all over the front of this stage for 21 days of prayer and fasting. And in your welcome guide, I want you to find a card. It looks like this. It's a little, it's a prayer card. You can put your name on there, or if you don't want to put your name on there, but then it's got a place for you to say, please pray for. And this is your opportunity to have prayer requests for yourself, for your family, for your friends, for your coworkers, for whatever it is, and then have people in the church praying for this for the next 3 weeks, literally. And so I would love for you to just take that out and at some point up in the front end of the message, go ahead and write in a prayer request, or maybe something will come to you as we get into the message. And then at the end, when we receive our offering, you can just drop that in the offering container, and then that's going to be prayed over from here going out. So I want to share today, and I forgot to put my watch on after worship because I clap, and I don't want this thing to go flying. That happened once. It came apart. And by the way, just because pastor puts a watch on doesn't mean he looks at it. Today's service is 3 hours, right? No, I'm teasing. So I'll get you out of here on time. No, I want to share with you really what I think is the secret to a productive, fruitful, and fulfilled life. And I think this is going to be really, really helpful for you. And it really starts out with a scripture. It's the first scripture in the Bible, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, and it's this, and you may know it already. It's in the beginning, say it with me, God. In the beginning, God. That's really the secret to living a life. See, God in the beginning of your relationships changes everything. When you put God in the beginning of you going to school, whether you're in grade school, middle school, high school, college, postgraduate work, in the beginning, God makes a huge difference. Putting God in the beginning of your work every day is vital and important. Putting God in the beginning of your everything makes the biggest difference. And so I want to encourage you, put God first in all these things. And this is why, church, this is why in the Old Testament, in the Ten Commandments, we have this written in Exodus chapter 20. Look at this with me. Exodus chapter 20, verse 1, it says, and God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. He's talking to Israel, but he's really talking to us too. For us that have a relationship with Christ, God has brought us out of the bondage and the slavery of sin and of serving the devil, and now he's brought us into freedom, into Christ. But he says this, you shall have no other gods before me. He's saying, I am to be first in your life. You can't say Lord and have God be in second place. It doesn't make sense. He's either at the top of your list or he's not on your list at all. And so he demands to be first, and the reason he can do that is because he gave his first and his best to us in his son, Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? He never asks us of anything he hasn't already given us. And so he asks us to be putting him in first place. And that really is the key to success in life. So I want to talk to you a few minutes about the principle of the first and really expand this and unpack this. So go ahead and pull out your notes. Pull out your message notes. They're in your welcome guides, or you can get on our app, download that, and then all the notes are on there. You can just fill in the blanks, and then you can archive that electronically. But the principle of the first says this: in any realm, what the first is and what is done with the first determines all the rest. And that's true really for anything. I want you to just picture when they build a huge stone building, the first thing they would set in a ceremony is the cornerstone. And when they set that cornerstone, that means that the building is going to go out in exactly this direction and then 90 degrees exactly that direction. So they're very careful to orient that properly because that's going to determine the entire rest of the building. And Jesus Christ is the cornerstone. And you and I are living stones, we're told in the New Testament. Lively, living stones being built up as a temple unto God. Can you say amen? So just kind of just give the person next to you kind of a fist bump and say, hey, you're lively. Maybe that woke him up. I don't know. But that friction of being a living stone means God is using the person to your right and to your left to help shape you and help conform you into the image of Christ. And that's a truth that if you can grab a hold of, you're going to appreciate people rather than want to run away from them. Because sometimes the people we want to run fastest and farthest from are the very people that God wants to use to help shape us. And so Jesus is this cornerstone. He orients everything. And he's also a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. You know, you watch a talk show, they can say, you know, God this and God that all they want, but they mention the name of Jesus and it's like, uh-oh. Like somebody like crossed a line. Something changes. And so we want to make it easy for people, easy for Menominee Falls, easy for Sussex, easy for Mequon and Thiensville and Grafton and Cedarburg and Germantown and all the surrounding areas, Waukesha, all these areas. We want to make it easy for people to be able to have access to the gospel. But we will never compromise what the gospel is. We're going to make it easy to get in here, easy to get a cup of coffee, easy to find a seat. It's getting a little harder, but easy to find a seat, easy to have a place. But we're never going to be apologetic and water down the gospel because the gospel is the offense. And we're going to make it easy to that point. And then once that's presented, that's what it is. Then we can make a decision. And we make no apologies about that. Because I believe in no compromise Christianity. And I'm looking for people, I'm looking for leaders to walk with that'll say, you know what? Heaven and earth may pass away, but the word of God is going to remain forever. And we're not moving and budging off what the word says. We're going to stand firm and love well in a culture that's compromised. And I think that's a real key. We don't have to get mean about anything. And I'm not here to call anybody out. I got issues. You got issues. All God's children got issues. You know what I'm saying? And I'm working on my own stuff. So I'm not calling out this person and that ministry and whatever. But I'm telling you, the nation and our area, our region, is looking for churches and people that love God and love them. Can you say amen? Amen. You know, the first things have power. They really do. Whether you're a Christian or not, your priorities say a lot about you and who you are. And so I want you to write this down. This is just the first principle. Write this down. Give God the first of everything. Just give him the first of everything, and you'll have success in life. You know, we spent the entire fall, for those of you who weren't with us, the entire fall, the autumn, teaching about generosity and giving and tithing and offering and all that, how meaningful that is. Just all those messages are archived. You can listen to all that, and it's all good. But it's bigger than even that. It's really bigger than that. It's about priority. The first being and having priority in life. You know, Deuteronomy chapter 14, and I just love the way verse 23 says this. The purpose of tithing, here it is to teach you always to put God first. It's not about even the giving part. It's about putting God first. That's really what it's about. It's about the priority of the first things. So let me show you four places in 2023 where you can put God first and have success. Are you ready? Amen. All right, write this down. Number one, give God the first of your year. Give him the first of your year. Here at Metro Harvest, this is why we start the year with 21 days of prayer and fasting. We put him first. We give him the first and the best of the year. And as it's already been said, we're very, very intentional about that. And we want to help you enter into the next step in your level of commitment and whatever that is. And so many of us do have questions on what fasting's all about. Well, I want to help you with that. I want to unpack that with you this morning. You know, Jonathan mentioned we put a lot of material on the website. Go access that. There's devotionals on there. There's helpful things. But I want to unpack just a little bit with you the different kinds of fasts that exist in the Bible. You know, Jesus said, when you fast. Not if you fast. He said, when you fast. And so here's the first one. Go ahead and write this down. There's something called the complete fast. A complete fast. And this fast calls for only drinking liquids. Okay? Whether that's water or light fruit juices. And I want to say this about a complete fast. You should never enter into a complete fast without some medical advice. Okay, talk to your doctor. See if it's a good idea for you. You may have a medical condition that precludes you from going into that. Just use plain common sense is what I'm trying to say. But a complete fast is really, that's a very, very serious fast. And it really takes a lot of commitment and sacrifice. And there may be some doing that in here in 2021. I did a water-only fast during this time. And I came out on the other end, a few clothes sizes different. But I came out of 2020 going, boy, if 2020 was like this, I don't know what 2021 holds. I was seeking God, and I just jumped in, okay? But that fast may not be for everybody, and I don't want you to in any way feel like if you're not fasting at that level, you're not like pulling your own weight or something. Because a fast is between you and the Lord, right? This isn't about, oh, well, you know, this is what I'm doing, you know. You know, that's not what this is about, okay? If you did that, you already blew it. Because a fast is about humbling ourselves. Here's the second one I want you to write down, a selective fast. And this type of fast involves just removing certain elements from your diet. Now, many of you have heard of a Daniel fast, and this is in the book of Daniel, Daniel and three of his friends. They took things out of their diet, and generally it was meat, it was all sweets, and it was alcohol. And so you would just remove elements out of your diet in a selective fast, whatever those elements are, whatever the Lord's telling you to remove. And so then it's primarily water and fruit juice plus whatever you're choosing to eat, okay? A lot of beans, you know, a lot of rice, just depending on your recipes and all of that. But when you remove things, I want to encourage you to remove the things that it's a sacrifice. Like if desserts are your thing, you want to remove them. If chocolate is your deal, You want to say goodbye for 3 weeks to chocolate because it's a sacrifice. You know, sugar, soda, whatever it is, you know, just give it up for God. And that will help you to take a next step in consecration and commitment to the Lord. See, for me, and I mentioned this last week, for me, fasting Brussels sprouts or anchovies, no problem whatsoever. And you know why? Because I don't go anywhere near them any other time of year. I won't touch them. Even with a lot of butter and a lot of salt, because that helps. But I'm just saying, if it's not a sacrifice, you know, God knows that and God sees that. And then there's a partial fast. Write that down. A partial fast. Some people call this a Jewish fast. And this is really fasting certain meals during the day, like maybe you fast breakfast and lunch, but then you eat supper. Okay? That's a partial or a Jewish fast. For the first 12 years of my ministry, I did a partial fast every other day, because that's what I felt it took to get a church beachhead in this area when we started the church. I just really felt that we just needed to push that hard. And for 12 years, that it was a lifestyle fast for me. And so a partial fast may be something you want to investigate during this 3 weeks. And then the final one is a soul fast. Now, what's a soul fast? Well, it's any area of the soul, your mind, your will, your emotions. So you can fast social media, maybe fasting movies, maybe fasting TV, maybe fasting sports or the news. Just giving up something that you usually feed your soul with. Just to get away from life as usual. And that's really what fasting is all about, church. It's fasting helps us disconnect from the world. Just disconnect from the world. And then prayer helps us connect to God. And trust me, as you move into this, you're going to start hearing God in a very clear way as more time goes on. And so you may want to replace some of these meals or whatever just with praying. And it just gives you that extra time to spend in God's Word. You know, if you started adding up how many times we spend on Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, you know, you'd be surprised. Surfing YouTube, that's my thing, you know, just, you know, oh, that looks good. Any biblical archaeology show, and then the algorithm just starts feeding them. Oh, it's only 10 minutes. It's only 12 minutes. It's only 21 minutes. It's only 43 minutes. And then pretty soon it's like, it's only a day. Right? So just find something that in this time that you can actually enter into the fast. It's 21 days of prayer and fasting. That's why we do it. Here's the second thing that you can put God first in. Give God the first of your month, okay? Give him the first of your month. And here's the key. I want you to write this down. Scheduling, and here's the B word, budgeting. Ooh. Yeah, I know. Scheduling and budgeting. I like to say it this way. Put the big rocks in the jar first. Then put the stones, then put the pebbles, then put the sand. Figure out your priorities in your scheduling. Don't so overschedule yourself that you find you've scheduled yourself to be in two places at one time, because that's always a mess. But make sure you have some sanity in your meetings, in your travel, in your activities. Have some thought that goes into it at the front end of the month. Don't overextend yourself. Build in some downtime, okay? That's really, really important, I think. And in your budgeting, just budget God first. Just make it easy. Just God, the first and my best is yours. And then I want to encourage you too, in 2023, build up that emergency fund. In your household, build up an emergency fund. Have some margin, okay? Save for a vacation so you don't have to put it on a credit card, so that you can actually enjoy it and not enjoy it, then have to pay for it down the road. I always hated that. And so we just changed. We said, you know what? We're gonna save up for this. And if we want to go someplace really nice, we're gonna have to save up really nice. It's just gonna take a little time. So you want to give God the first of your month. Here's the third thing, write this down. Give God the first of your week. Give God the first of your week. And so here's the key: worshiping and replenishing. Worshiping and replenishing. I want you to make it a commitment in 2023 to attend public worship. You see, the gathered church, that's the public witness of the church. And that's why during COVID, it was so hard when things were getting shut down. And now we're on the back end of this. We've got problems that we're having to deal with because of the isolation. You were never designed by God to live alone on an island. You know what I'm saying? Maybe as attractive as that seems to the most severe introvert. You know, all my people credits are all done. Just back off. But none of us was designed to be completely alone and isolated. And so, you know, too many have just lost the priority of gathering and fellowship in the church. And this is why we are working so hard to give you opportunities that you can come together every Sunday, every Sunday. And life groups are... Life groups are, I did not pay anybody to do that, by the way. Life groups are starting up at the end of the month. So we're going to be signing up on the 29th and on the 5th so you can get together. Read it in your Bible, Acts 20, verse 20. They met publicly and house to house. And so every week we're going to have an opportunity for you to hang out with your friends and grow in your faith. And then quarterly, we've got around the table. Now, we outgrew the kid zone. Now we're in this room. I think last time we had like 75, 70-some people here. And the whole agenda is just to eat. Come on, how about that? Not during 21 days. But it will come back around. You know, and to hang out and talk and play Jenga and, you know, just hang out. Fellowship. So there's opportunities to do that. And it's so very, very important. That's what replenishes us. And so I want to encourage you, take Sundays, just set aside the day to refocus. Just refocus. And just kind of think through a little bit, okay, what's coming up? What do we got to look forward to? Take time to prepare so that you can make a difference and be productive when you're at school, or be productive on your job or in your business, if you're a business owner. You know, Sunday nights, I really encourage you, pull your phone out and just like, what does my week hold? You know? No, I know tonight, like half the country is going to be watching the Packers-Lions game. And that's okay. But don't make how you go into your week whether you win or lose. You know what I'm saying? Don't let them put you on that emotional roller coaster. All right? You know, if you win and you're in, great. If you lose and you're out, well, maybe next year. It's going to be okay. I'm your pastor. I love you guys. I really love you guys. You're family. And so I don't want to see anybody just losing it. Whatever happens tonight or next week or the following week, you know... There's probably two people in this room that can tell me who won the Super Bowl in 1978. And I don't want to know. But I'm just saying, most of us are like... Okay, that's one. No, didn't know that. All I'm saying is, don't stumble into Monday. Okay? All right? Amen. If you get it, say got it. All right, good. All right, here's the fourth thing. Give God the first of your day. Give Him the first of every day. And you want to spend time with God. Right at the beginning. Let me say it this way. Write this down in your notes. Book Jesus. Okay? Put him into your calendar. Book Jesus. Make him your first appointment of the day. And this is why. You'll never change in life if you don't change something you do daily. Let me say that again. You will never change anything in life unless you change something daily. And this is a great thing to change if it's not a consistent habit yet. Give God the first part and the best part of your day. And so how do you do this? How do you do this? Well, let me give you a place to start, okay? Give them the first 15. Every one of us can do this, but this is a good place to start. Give them the first 15. Write this down. Give him 5 minutes. Give 5 minutes in the Word, all right? Now, I encourage, like on YouVersion, you can do a one-year Bible where it takes a little bit of Old Testament, a little bit of New Testament, Psalms, and Proverbs. And trust me, when in February, you know, you're in Leviticus, you just gotta have some Psalms as well. But here's the deal. Here's the deal. If you've only got 5 minutes, then get into the New Testament or get into Psalms. Give 5 minutes to God in that way. Here's the second thing. Give God 5 minutes in worship. Take 5 minutes. 5 minutes to worship God. Just start thanking Him. Just close your eyes and begin to thank God. Tell Him how much you love Him. Tell Him how much you appreciate what He's done for you. Just begin to love Him back. And just allow your heart to get quiet with Him. And just worship Him. I'm telling you that 5 minutes won't be enough. But it's a good place to start. And then the last thing would be give Him 5 minutes in prayer. Give Him 5 minutes. Take your requests to Him. Tell Him what's on your heart. I want you to write this in your notes because this may be a new thought to some of you. In 2023, I want you to confide in the Holy Spirit. Maybe you've been not telling Him some stuff because it just, maybe it hurts or it's shameful to you. But He loves you just the way you are. Okay? You see, He already knows what it is, and He loves you. So begin to confide in the Holy Spirit. Listen, 15 minutes is a great place to start. Jesus hung on the cross for you and I for 6 hours. Is it too much to ask to begin to draw near to Him in this way? And here's the last way to implement the principle of the first. And I'd like to have the worship team to come on up here. Expect God to bless the rest. Expect Him to bless the rest of everything else. Remember, in any and every realm, what the first is and what is done with the first, here it is, determines all the rest. So when we put God first this way, then expect Him that He's going to bless the rest of it. Maybe write this down in your margins. Add faith to your focus this year. In whatever you're believing for, add faith to your focus. What are you believing God for in 2023? What are your prayer requests for 21 days? What are you looking and asking God to accomplish in your life in this time? I want to encourage you to expect God to bless you when you put Him first. Matthew, who was a follower of Jesus, he was a government worker, worked for the IRS, and then he decided, I'm going to follow Jesus full time. He wrote this down. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 8, verse 33. But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. This is what I'm talking about. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and then all these other things are going to be added to you. There was a song years ago, and for anybody over the age of, you probably remember this, it was, don't worry, be happy. Well, there's truth to that. When we choose not to worry and just let God be who He is in first place, then all these other things will be added unto you. He knows that you need food, church. He knows that you need clothing. He knows that you need a warm place to sleep at night. He knows that you need to be gainfully employed. He knows that you desire and need close relationships, especially family relationships. He knows that you need a place where you can come and live out your faith and get encouraged and then go outside these walls and live out your faith and encourage others. He knows all that. And so He says, seek first the kingdom of God, His righteousness, then all these other things will be added unto you. What I would like to do is I want to pray for you right up at the front end of this 21 days of prayer. And then I want to give people here and then for those of you watching at home, or wherever you are and whenever you are, because you can watch this on demand, I want to give you an opportunity then to put God first in your life. And for some of you, that may be saying, I need to say yes to Jesus. Or for others, you may need to say yes to Jesus once more. I'm going to ask all of us, and even you at home, just go ahead and close your eyes and bow your heads. Just make that chair where you're sitting the place where you meet God today. Now, Heavenly Father, You are faithful and You are true. You always keep Your promises. And I thank You that You're not going to blow a perfect track record on me or anybody in this room or anybody watching. You always keep Your promises. Lord, as we enter into this 21 days of prayer and fasting, God, we give You permission to sort through our lives. Lord, we give You permission to shine Your light on every area that needs to be conformed to the image of Christ. And then to help us, Lord, become the people that you dreamed about as you hung on the cross and died for us. Lord, I'm asking that on the other end of these 3 weeks, we will have developed some habits and actions that we will carry into day 22 because you have changed some attitudes and motives in our hearts and lives. Father, I pray for everyone here, everyone watching, everyone within the sound of my voice. That is wrestling with any doubt about where they stand with you. Jesus, we know that one day we will stand before you in all of your holiness, and you will look through us with those flaming eyes of love. And you will look for the covering of the shed blood of Jesus Christ over our lives, over the doorposts of our hearts, and the lintels of all that we do in life. So, Father, for anybody here today that does not have a 100% assurance that in their heart they know that they know that they know, that if today were their last day on this earth, that they would stand before you and you would say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master," and the gates of heaven would be open to them. Father, if there are any people here or any people watching, I pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would bring them to the place of surrender to you. Now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you sense that I'm talking to you right now, or you know that you once knew God, but somehow you've drifted away and you've got to get back to Him, today is the day to make that decision. With everyone praying, if you would like to be included in on a prayer, I'm going to help you make that decision. It's not about joining this church. It's about getting right with God. If you want to be included in that prayer, would you just lift up your hand so that God can see it, so that I can see it? Just lift it up high. Yes, God bless you. Yes, God bless you. Are there others? You'd say, "I just need to get right with God today. I need to get back to God." Are there others? Yes, God bless you. Just want to wait a moment more. Okay, you can go ahead. Oh, yes, yes. Sorry, yes. Okay, you can put your hands down. Okay, I want to lead you in a prayer. And there's nothing magic about this prayer. It's just going to help you connect your faith to that free gift that Christ is offering to you. It says, "By grace you have been saved through faith. That not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, so that none of us can boast." If you are ready to make that decision and mean it in your heart, then let's all pray this together just to get around those that are making that decision today. Just repeat after me. Heavenly Father, you sent Jesus for moments just like this. Lord, I'm at a crossroads. I know I need you, and I want to take a step of faith. I receive you, Lord, as my Savior. Forgive me of my sins. I believe you died for me. I believe you rose again. And because you rose, I'm alive. I'll have eternal life. And I will walk with you all the days of my life. Thank you, Lord, for choosing me. I choose you, and I love you today. Thank you, Lord, with all my heart. And I pray in Jesus' name.